How can a trip to the audiologist reduce your risk for dementia? That's our topic today on Ask the Hearing Doctors. Hi, I'm Jim Cuddy, and this is Ask the Hearing Doctors. And I'm joined today by Dr. Anna Anzola, Doctor of Audiology and Principal of Hearing Doctors, the Washington, D.C. area's highest rated audiology practice with over 2,500 five-star reviews. Also joining us today, Dr. Keith Darrow, certified dementia practitioner, audiologist, and neuroscientist, studying firsthand how the brain ages and what role hearing plays in the process. Anna, Keith, great to see you both.
Thank you so much.
So Keith, let's start. How did you become interested in hearing and brain health?
Oh, that one's easy. My mother told me to do it. In all seriousness, which that is half true, I was looking for a field to help others. I naively went off to college and said, I'll do social work. Right? Wanted to be some sort of psychotherapist. Well, long story made short, once I found out that I would probably have to go to graduate school and go to college even longer, I said, I don't know if this is for me. And then my mother said, why not take a class and learn about speech pathology and audiology? Sure. That was it. That first class completely changed the trajectory of my life. Because I then not only completed my undergrad, I then went on for a few more years to obtain my clinical audiology degree, and then went for another 6 years to obtain a PhD in neuroscience from both Harvard Medical School and MIT. So it really is true what they say. When you find something you love, it's like you never work another day. And so I stumbled into it. But along the way, I've become more obsessed with the concept of how the ear and the brain interact. Because not only the literature and the research about how hearing loss impacts our ability to think and cognition, but I saw it firsthand. I saw firsthand the demise of my own grandmother and how she lost vision, she lost hearing, and sure enough, the dementia was quick to follow. And so I had this like single case study right in front of me wherein my grandmother was dealing with sensory impairment that was absolutely leading to that dementia and just watched her whittle away. And so I feel like it's now my mission to help educate others on what is dementia, is it preventable? If so, how can you do it? So on. So
talk about some of the different side effects of hearing loss. Dementia to me seems to be kind of the end game in the whole thing, whereas there are a lot of other almost yeah. steps towards it, if you will.
Yeah, so the way I think about it is, and if you're a patient, a person listening to this, I want you to think about these five symptoms, right? So are you struggling to understand what other people say, right? So did you ever have the sense of, I can hear you, but I don't understand everything you're saying? So a lack of clarity is very common in people with hearing loss. And then I would ask, are you having difficulty in background noise? So you go to a restaurant, it's pretty loud, and it's like you're struggling to follow a conversation. That's a sign that there's a problem. Could it be that you have ringing in your ears? For many patients, that's actually number one, where the tinnitus or tinnitus comes on first. That is a sign, a side effect of hearing loss. Then you have sensitivity to loud sounds, right? So you go to like a concert venue or a wedding, and it's like, it's just so loud, but everybody else doesn't seem to have a problem with it. And then finally, issues with memory. So issues with remembering words, names, you know, what did I do yesterday? Like you're just, look, I think the average person calls it senior moments. Right. So when you get to a point where you're like, I feel like I'm having too many senior moments or something's not right here. Well, that could be the hearing loss contributing to potential cognitive decline. Mm-hmm.
We've often talked, Anna, about get in early, get your ears checked regularly. I mean, people don't get their ears checked regularly. You know, you go to the dentist twice a year, you get your eyes checked every year, that kind of thing. People aren't checking out their hearing.
Right. And so that's our mission here. So I love the passion that he's bringing to the conversation, because I think that it's our job as audiologists to be forward thinking about how we can help the person as a whole, right? It's beyond the ears. I want to know, you know, what the brain is doing, how that cortical function of the brain and versus what the ears or the hearing is doing, and how we can really help them create a very specific treatment plan for them. Because that's gonna, at the end of the day, that's where we get the best outcomes.
There, and I, from personal experience watching my own mother, there's denial. My ears are fine. You're not speaking up. You need to, or you're turning up the TV louder. Certainly signs that, gosh, maybe I need to do something and get my ears checked. But the importance of doing that as soon as you notice, as opposed to putting it off, what do you see, Keith, on a daily basis in that regard?
So here's, right, when the best prognosis for treating diabetes is if you catch it early. The best prognosis for cancer is if you catch it early and treat it early. Well, same thing for hearing loss, right? Except most people don't put hearing loss up on that pedestal. Yet, hearing loss is the number one sensory disorder on the planet. And it's listed number three, third most common chronic condition affecting older adults. I think the issue is too many people think it's normal for my age and this is just what's supposed to happen, not realizing the side effects, right? So the side effects being the social isolation, the cerebral atrophy, right? So which is a big fancy word for people with hearing loss, they may have loss of like the size of their brain. Like this, the brain could actually shrink in somebody with hearing loss, which is a very hallmark feature in a brain that has dementia. And then there's this cognitive overload, which is like working really hard to follow a conversation. And so those three factors are really what bring together the strong links of hearing loss and cognitive decline.
Mm-hmm. The research that's out there, and some of this is more than 10 years old, which is fascinating to me that we're still struggling to get people to come in and see an audiologist and get your ears checked because the research is out there. But things like 40% cases of dementia are maybe not preventable, but you could at least curb it, slow it down.
Consider preventable. Those are the words from the Lancet, which is the European Dementia Commission that published a report in 2017 and then again in 2020. But I want to back up for a second. So, I appreciate that you know that there's been data around for 10 or so years. The very first indication that people with hearing loss have something cognitively happening to them is over 50 years old, right? There was a paper that came out in the 80s that made a very bold statement that this group of people over here that have hearing loss seem to have higher rates of cognitive decline and dementia. But that paper was kind of ignored. Then fast forward to 2011, John Hopkins, right, an indisputable leader in healthcare and research, put out the report, and I'm going to summarize it. Hearing loss increases your risk of cognitive decline and dementia by 200 to 500%. Like, let that really sink in. So people who say, oh, I just have a mild hearing loss, I say, okay. So you're only at 200% increased risk of cognitive decline and dementia. Like that's how serious it is. And I think that's what gets at the catch it early and treat it early. Because if we can treat it early, perhaps we could curb your inclination or your disposition to developing decline and dementia.
You know, we often talk about, or you hear about, you read about, if you change your diet and your exercise routine and that kind of thing, you can, in fact, there are plenty of studies that say you can prevent illnesses or you can get over illnesses more quickly. Is there anything that would suggest diet and exercise would aid in hearing loss and or dementia?
I mean, look, a healthy diet, healthy exercise, these are really important things, right? But let me summarize, because what I really love that came from the Lancet Commission report, again, 2017, updated in 2020, two facts that I think everybody needs to know. 40% of cases of dementia are considered preventable. So the way I always try to illustrate that to people is imagine a room filled with 100 people that have dementia. 40 of them didn't have to be there. Maybe my grandmother. If I always say if I knew them what I know now, maybe I could have helped her to prevent it. So that's probably one of the most important things for people to realize. Dementia is considered preventable in 40% of cases. Now, the follow-up question is, what do I got to do to be part of that 40%? And I don't blame you, but if you ask the average person, you know, just stop somebody on a street going by and say, hey, what do you think it takes to prevent dementia? I got to eat better, sleep better, exercise. All true. But what the report put out was 12 modifiable lifestyle factors. So 12 things that have been shown in the literature. If you do them, they will significantly reduce your risk of cognitive decline and dementia. Guess what's number one on the list of 12 modifiable factors that you can do to reduce your risk of cognitive decline and dementia? Tell them.
Treating your hearing loss. That is the number one modifiable risk factor of cognitive decline. So, hey, if I can treat it and I can help our patients and their family, it's huge. I've done my job.
Right, right.
And get this one. But treating hearing loss is on the list, right? It's actually number one on the list. Well, guess what else is on the list? Social integration, which treating hearing loss allows people to reintegrate, to not be socially isolated. We also know that treating hearing loss helps people be more physically active. Guess what else is on the list? Being more physically active. If you're more physically active, you may be able to reduce your diabetes, cardiovascular disease, all on the list. So I really come from a holistic standpoint, as does the hearing doctors, of treat the whole person. So yes, we're gonna treat your hearing loss and we're gonna address that issue. But the downstream effects of being able to not only reintegrate, but live a healthier and better life, I really believe in my heart that it has a cumulative effect to not only increase quality of life, but really help keep dementia at bay.
Well, you know, and it, like I said in the beginning, you know, all of those things sort of, it's like a step ladder towards dementia. If you take care of all of these things, you don't have to get to that last step, right? Now, Anna, you are also a certified dementia practitioner. And I know that when folks come in here, it's not just about checking their hearing. There's a lot more to what you can offer somebody who's having hearing loss. There are other things that you are able to do and test here.
Yeah. And so it all started with education. Everything starts with education, right? But to me, I thought I need to empower myself with more education so I can really do the best job that I can for the most optimal outcomes for our patients. And it our patients find it, you know, quite interesting that I know how to travel through, you know, the journey that they're going through with empathy. And I think that's really important and critical. So we take the time to also educate our staff so that they actually know how to talk to them on the phone, how to do it in person and with their family members.
And I want to compliment Dr. Anna, because I've worked with a lot of hearing healthcare providers, but you've really invested in yourself and in your team on really understanding how hearing loss interacts with the brain, how hearing loss can increase the risk of cognitive decline and dementia. And she must be applauded, because part of your regular protocol is actually doing cognitive screenings to look at, is my patient at increased risk? Not only because of their hearing loss, but what about other factors and the way they process, which can help with a referral to a neurologist or a primary care physician and potentially catch it early and treat it early.
And that's really key. So we have a much better relationship with our referring physicians, because they really do appreciate that extra information so that they can actually treat it earlier too.
And the families that come in here with their loved one and the loved one themselves, once, you know, things are moving along and we're heading in the right direction, I would imagine there's a great sense of relief there as well.
Sure. Absolutely. And we do it with every patient. Every patient that comes through our doors, we do it. We measure the improvements, which is really great, because we know, okay, this is where we started without hearing aids or a hearing device or tinnitus for that matter. And then you start showing improvement. And that is really critical for us.
This has been eye-opening to me, especially when you think, I'm one of that crowd that would say, well, you can't treat dementia. You can't really do anything. You can't prevent it. We've learned a whole lot today. And it all starts with just getting your ears checked and do it regularly.
Absolutely.
How often should somebody go see an audiologist?
So I've got a little catchphrase that you should get your first hearing test when you turn 50. And you know how to remember that? Ears and rears. Because that's what we do when we're 50, right? So you've got to check up here, you got to check down there. And so that's really your first opportunity to get in. Now here, all joking aside, the average, get this one, the average patient who's diagnosed with dementia sometime in their early 70s, it is fully understood by the scientific community that that dementia has been brewing, presymptomatic is what we call it, presymptomatic dementia has been building for the last 20 years. So it's not like it's just, I mean, they may be showing outward signs only for 6 months or a year, but it's been building. And so that real critical window is thought to be between about 50 and 70. So it's really important to catch your hearing loss early and treat it. And here's another not so well-known statistic. The average age of a patient who starts treating their hearing loss is also in their early 70s. And guess when that hearing loss started? In their 50s.
Right.
Wow.
I don't want to make any, you know, bold assumptions or statements, but those timelines align almost perfectly. And so I feel like our job is to help let people know, get your hearing tested early. And the great news is when we catch it early, we can treat it early. You have a better prognosis and you will have a better quality of life.
It's just about making an appointment.
That's it.
It's
That's
not
it.
That big a deal. and yet it's a really, really big deal.
Yeah.
For what your life can be versus what it shouldn't be.
Right.
Anna, Keith, thank you both very much.
Thank you.
If you're in the Washington metropolitan area and you'd like to schedule an appointment with hearing doctors, click the link in the description or visit hearingdoctors.com.